Hey everyone. So I'm doing an update tonight to just kind of talk about what's going on with Doom. I haven't really been able to get any new footage for my Doom 2 level because I don't think anybody wants to play my map anymore. So maybe I just haven't been like advertising, or maybe people are just waiting for it to be finished or something like that. The only thing is in order for me to finish it, I need to be able to get people to play it so that I can see where I need to fix. I also have a feeling that a lot of people think that when they see the level, that's how it's going to be. Maybe they're used to like other level designers who like refuse to fix their shit, or people who treat their levels like they're babies. That's totally not my style. Like, I mean, I'm definitely treating the level like it's my baby, but I don't want it to be a shitty baby, because shitty babies aren't fun. Shitty baby. What's a shitty baby? All right. Hold on. I'm just gonna drink this coffee. All right. So I'm talking about my Doom 2 level, but in all of the chaos of releasing my my RPG template and Quake template, I've actually been kind of kicking around a version of a new project that's based sort of on Quake Template's ideas, but is much more cleanly designed and is being done actually properly using data tables. And I've been just going through and hooking everything up. There's actually a hell of a lot of infrastructure in here. Hold on a second, I could show you like what I currently have in place so far, and like the general direction. I make the console command go away. Bothering me. Okay. So like you'll see right here, this is like the HUD for everything is a lot cleaner. There's actually more stats. I decided to go with a different damage system. I decided to go with a whole bunch of other stuff. Like, it's all here. I've been actually hooking up the inventory system before I've been getting to the weapons and all of that other stuff, which a lot of that stuff kind of just falls into place once I have the backbone of the project. And the project is definitely coming along, like, but it's a little bit at a time. Anyway, I ended up just taking a look at it and realizing that I'd actually had an awful lot of infrastructure in place, and that the methodologies that I've been using aren't really that hard to follow. It's a little weird, though. It's like jumping through hoops if you want to know how to do this stuff perfectly correctly. You do have to kind of like figure out some weird hoops to jump through. For example, like, You have to have a struct in order for you to be able to use a data table. So I've kind of come up with my own system. I'll show a working example. So here's all the boosters. Boosters are basically stat, like potions. You take the potion and it gives you a stat for a certain amount of time, right? So you have to have a struct, and you have to have a data table to go with it, because the data table won't work without a struct. And then data tables look like this if it opens up, and you can see basically the stats for each of these things, and they're all pointing towards effects, which is a booster effect, which is a status thing, and there's actually quite a bit already here. So status effects, boosters, right? And then there's like health regen, shield regen. This is for like when you use a shield generator. So like instead of armor, you now have a shield, so it's a little bit like Borderlands. And if you look in the game, like, you'll notice that there are additional stats for like shield and then mega shield. So your health and your shield kind of work together in a very similar way, rather than being like two completely different entities entirely. Yeah, pretty much like all this really cool stuff, it's actually being done properly. So, like, if I do actually get this to a point where you can run around and shoot stuff with it and pick up and loot things and kill bad guys with it, I will actually put this on the marketplace, because this is how you're supposed to do it, and this is a good example of how not to kill the engine while you're making something that's fairly complicated. So that actually could be really good. The only thing is I really don't want I don't want fiat cash. I just want Bitcoin, man. So hopefully maybe there's something else I could do, like I could sell my mod for Bitcoin. That's where it's at. Like, I don't want this. I don't want normal money. I want cool money. Anyway, there's other things as well. This one's actually a lot more robust in that it actually has character classes. So you have Scout, Soldier, Enforcer, the base classes. Everything's very much set in interesting ways here. And I can actually do something real quick just to kind of go over this. So I'm doing damage types. So they call them modifier types. A modifier type can be is the entity that spawns whenever somebody is an object that just spawns whenever somebody is hit by a weapon or uses like a their health is being modified in some way, right? So then you have whether or not the effect is harmful, what's the icon of it, what's the name of the modifier type. So like it can be like ballistic damage, or it could be sound wave damage or something like that. Does it ignore mitigation, so it completely goes through your shields and armor, and recovery goes above max, which is like armor shard, health shards, and mega health goes above 100%. And those are the only things I could think of at the moment. Right now I'm still just kind of getting the infrastructure in place, but now you see now that I have this struct, right, you'll notice that there's two, just to clear things up so I'm only looking very specific. Okay, so here's the base class in which all of these other classes that are down here, these two folders, are derived. And now each of these folders have a base class as well. So here's the parent, and then the parent, and then the child goes here, and then within this folder are all the other children that, so like all the different types of damage, which there probably won't be because it's not really necessary for this, but having the infrastructure in place just in case I do decide to have like poison damage and shit like that, could all be right here. I'm not really planning on doing that for this project, but it's something that this supports. So this right here needs these objects need to point to something that's significant, right? Like these need to actually be told what they are, because it's just right now they're just copies of the original base class, and that's where you have to have a data table. So I make a data table. Now I have to pick the struct. Now this is kind of funny because I was telling you, like in my other videos, I was saying like don't ever use structs because you'll kill things. No, if you're using structs with data tables, you're in a much better position. It's not going to have the same problems. It can't. It just, a lot of the stuff that went wrong with data tables, it's way less likely to be a problem with this. So I'm looking at damage. This would be modifier types. So where are you, modifier types? There you are. All right. Okay, so I got a PS damage type. Data table, right? Okay, so now I have to, right now I'm only going to just have the one, which is going to be called PS damage generic. So I'll just grab that name. I'm going to take that. Boom. Now, you can, when it comes to data tables, I can have like 20 or 30 different types of damage, 20 or 30 of these different categories, and they can all have their own stats. It's really easy to apply. Like, I might have more than one just because I want to have a generic damage type that ignores armor and shields. Just for like scripted stuff, like if I want to kill something. So, I'm pretty sure that's something that'll just come in handy, so I'll call this generic damage I think I spelled that wrong. I just want to make sure. Yep, I spelled it right. Okay, so this one goes true. Mine ignores mitigation. And then this is just going to be regular. Obviously, it's going to be harmful. Generic damage, right? And then ignore today's fancy word is mitigation. Obviously this one is also going to be harmful. And recovery goes above max is irrelevant. I don't have icons yet. I'll have to figure out like how I'm going to set up icons for this because I'm going to need a lot of them. And I already have quite a few from the previous project. It's just if this is to be something that I'm going to sell, I can't use anything from the marketplace, which really sucks. But yeah, so like I just sitting here and looking at this project and I decided to kind of pick it back up again. Here's the thing though. I want to be done with my Doom 2 level. I want to be done with my Doom 2 level by the end of the month. And I can't really find anyone who's interested in playtesting it at the moment. I'm going to maybe tomorrow while I'm at work, I'll see if maybe I can get one of the playtesters there to do it, but I really need somebody to record a video of it. Like, so that I can watch the video, critique everything that went on in the video, and do all that. It's just, there's no interest. Like, people are just not interested. I don't know what's going on. It's like, I don't know what people are waiting for. But, I might just push forward and build the last fight. So it's basically just two more areas. Two more small level areas. Maybe three, because I might want to have like a lead up to the actual big final fight. Which, I'm not really sure exactly how I'm going to do it, but I just want it to be a really climactic, over the top, very, very interesting fight. Where it's, you're constantly having to move around, you're constantly trying to like stay alive while you're fighting a fight that like if I do ever get somebody to play, like if I get BZ Plasma to play it, he wouldn't be talking during the fight because he'd be so busy focused. Like that's my goal, is to make a fight where I literally get the guy to not be able to talk while he's playing that fight and actually hold him there for a good 5 minutes. If I can accomplish that, then it's a pretty solid, it'll be pretty solid. Of course, if I go too far, I'll end up getting him to rage, which, I mean, it might be entertaining for the stream, but it's not going to be good for me. But if I don't do it enough, then he's going to be, like, talking to chat while he's hiding behind a corner as a couple of monsters. Like, this has to be a fight where it's your attention is focused, and I keep it there for a while. But one of the weird things that I've noticed is that if you design things in the manner that I've been designing them with my Doom 2 level, where it's like a series of like small area after small area, it's like eating potato chips, right? And it's the same problem that Half-Life had. It's like Every time you go to a new area, it's like real easy. Grab, it's like eating potato chips or popcorn or something, right? Like you do this one little thing, and then you go to the next area, and then you do the next thing. So, how do you end sequences like that? How do you end that without just making the player go into it gets you get angry because there's no more potato chips? You really can't end things in a good way. And a lot of, if a first person shooter is designed so that every area that you visit is the next potato chip, then you're just gonna have to, there's a challenge of figuring out how to like make the player satisfied after eating potato chips for a while. You no longer have any more potato chips. It's kind of a weird way to put it, but it's one of the hardest things about ending first person shooters. I think I, as far as I can tell, like with Call of Duty and Halo, they usually have like quick time events at the end. The reason why those things have are good to use at the end of a game is because they're dramatic for one, and for two, they kind of bore the player a little bit, so you're not like ready for the next potato chip. You're kind of glad it's over. You know what I mean? It's just sort of like overwhelming experience that happens near the very end, and you can definitely tell that you're mentally ready for it to end. You're kind of in the state. It's not like you just go in and hit a switch and the level's over. There's this like whole lead up with story and everything like that, and you kind of get to see this big conclusion. That shit don't exist in Doom. So basically, a player is just I have to throw some kind of a potato chip killing event. And I'm not cool with just making something super hard, fucking slaughter map, kind of just to throwing, 20 or 30 cyber demons at the player and expecting the player to enjoy that shit. It's not going to be fun. It's not, that's not a good experience. I'm not even sure why so many mappers seem to do that shit. All right. So with that said, I might actually make some videos that are just showing me working on this, because this project, Project Stray, it's called, and there was a Project Stray that I worked on in the past, but this is a take on everything that I've learned thus far to be able to actually create a first-person shooter in full blueprints without causing the engine to freak out on me. And it's taken many, many tries of fairly complicated projects for me to actually get to the point where I feel confident that I can actually pull it off. And so you're probably going to start seeing me veering off into Unreal 4 territory. So one of the things that I wanted to do once I finished the Doom 2 level is now begin applying that same exact Doom 2 level design style to something like Unreal Tournament 4. I can make bad guys, I can make levels where you have to find keys and open up doors in Unreal Tournament 4, right? But what if I can just do it in something like Project Stray? Well, I don't know. I might mess around with both ideas for a little bit, and I think it'll be a little bit better too, because I'll be actually working in a modern engine rather than Doom, because there's some people who think that that's all I'm really doing right now is just working with Doom 2. No, I don't just work with Doom 2. I do stuff for everything. Like I've worked in everything. Like if I had the fucking tools, I'd make a Call of Duty map for right now. I've done it all at some point or another. Hell, I'd show my shit on Warframe. I'd love to fucking like do like a stream where you just see me working on a Warframe map or something. I'd love to do that. Probably not gonna happen, but I've been working on all kinds of stuff. It's just that I'm really determined that Doom 2 level is like, I'm really determined to get it to a good point, because I want it to be the bar that sets, I want it to set the bar for all future projects. Mouse 1, mouse 1, mouse 2. This would be mouse 1, mouse 2, and then Q. Because I actually have ultimates, action points instead of stamina. are for like ultimates. Believe it or not, this is before I played. I started working on this before I even started playing Overwatch. But I think so. Yeah, I might actually have proof. But it'd be on my other channel though. Yeah, like I might actually be able to hook all this up and have it in a fairly workable state. Now this would be something to fucking to look at. Like if I release this, this is how you do it. This would be worth every penny if I was to release this. I don't want people paying money for the other projects because they taught bad habits. Okay, so that's about it. I'm gonna end the video here. Sorry it was so long. I wasn't really saying very much, I guess. But yeah, I'm gonna try and start getting some videos together, and hopefully I can find somebody to play test my Doom 2 level so that I don't have to fly blind when it comes to all the changes that I need to do in order to bring the map to a more complete state. It's depressing when it's like nobody's interested. Like, nobody seriously wants to play the map? Like, what the fuck? Like, I see people playing, like, constantly all these other maps. What the fuck do I have to do to get people interested in a level? Oh my god, I'm done. Alright. Stay tuned for more. There will be more. I am not giving up.